thanks so much for joining me. Today, my guest is Duncan MacGregor, and he is also known by the Kilted Chirstian. He's got a very popular podcast on Podbean. Duncan, thanks so much for joining me.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on.
So tell me a little, before we get started in the news of the day and some of the topics that you and I have discussed, and Scott Kesterson from Bards FM, we've discussed thoroughly. And you're one of the people that I go to when I hear that you have a podcast on. I listen to your podcast to get the latest, greatest information. But what is curious to me, Duncan, is how you got here. Why are you doing these podcasts? What is so interesting for you? And what was that thing that gave you the push to say, I'm going to start doing my own podcast?
Well, I went to school for film and video, and I had always been into this. So right around 2017, I went from being completely anti-establishment and started listening to Donald Trump and what he had to say, because he kind of sounded more like me, you know, talking about some what we would consider conspiracy theories, which turned out not to be conspiracy theories. So I started a show originally called Fortnite Patriots, and I did that one for about 6 months. And that was literally the day I started my show, was the day that Q made their first drop. And I'm into that kind of talk, you know, coded talk, you know, so it was kind of fun for me. And I ended up going in and doing a show called Payne's, or a video called Payne's Angels, which I've done about 130 of them. And they were just little 10 minutes, because I realized that people don't have real long attention spans anymore. So I started doing 10-minute videos and started getting a little traction doing these videos, because not many people were focusing on shorter videos about what was going on in the world. And the more I started looking or started following into the whole Q thing, the more I started to find God, which kind of was my biggest thing about that. And now I've kind of gotten away from, you know, the Q in general, and started focusing more on what's happening around this world altogether. And there was a time in my life where, you know, I wasn't the best person. I did some drugs. I was very inwardly destructive. And once I found God, my life just completely changed. So then it got to a point after the 2020 elections that I was like, you know, I need to do another show, because I was doing another show called Patriot Transition Voice. Then I started doing Kilted Chirstian because I wanted to focus more on the importance of God, because if we're going to get through this mess, God's going to be the one to take care of it. I never realized what a big mess in this world was. Being that I'm from, you know, Scotland and lived in the States, a lot of my life, I've got connections all over the world. So I'm realizing very quickly that they're having the same problems that we're having in our own country right now.
And, really?
Yes. And sadly, the media, mainstream media, is not showing any of this. So I felt that it was our duty, as citizens of our country, to do what we can to get this information out, whether it be the importance of finding God, whether it be the importance of learning what's happening in this world to wake up. Scott Kesterson from Bards FM and I became really good friends, because he reached out to me about the videos that I had done. He was a fan of, you know, how I produce those. I had him on my show, Patriot Transition Voice, and usually I went episode 1, 2, 3, 4, but whenever Scott would come on, he was Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, Delta. We had a special title for him.
We ended up coming
really, really close. And I've been basically doing video production and stuff for Bards FM ever since. And now we're in the process of growing Bards Nation into more than just Scott and Bards FM Fishers of Men, which is where I come in, which is where you come in, because we're kind of the beginning of this. And we need something to replace what I would call traditional media, because they've failed us. And now it's our duty to stand up and do what we can by bringing you the real news, what we're finding overseas, and then giving people hope, you know, letting them understand that ultimately God wins this. There's no point in being afraid right now. Right now, it's a time to find that courage, stand up, and find our voice.
I agree. You and I and Scott had a chance to talk. For 3 or 4 hours? How long was that?
I think it was a planning on just like an hour and a half or so for lunch, and ended up being, you know, 4 or 5 hours, something like that. And it was great, because we all have so much in common. Our lives are not only being affected on a worldwide and a national basis, but we have the same problems that we're dealing with internally, with family, with friends, and trying to help wake them up in a time where not many, you know, where some people are starting to wake up, but a lot of people are still kind of caught up in the old ways, and we're trying to change the system. So yeah, it was an absolute pleasure getting to meet you.
Yeah, it was a pleasure meeting you as well. And mentioned to you, I've been to Scotland a couple of times, but I know a little bit more about Scotland from the show, the series called Outlander, and just picked up a couple of things. You haven't seen that yet, have you?
I've yet to see it. And I get made fun of a lot for that because
really,
well, there's certain shows like Game of Thrones I haven't seen yet.
Oh, yeah, people, I haven't either.
People assume like the Scot, you know, who's totally into his history, would be the first one to watch these shows. But I'm also cheap and don't pay for HBO or any of that other stuff. So I'll catch that.
Probably a good thing. Okay, so let's switch gears. There's so much going on in the world, from President Trump's raid, not his raid, but the raid on President Trump at Mar-a-Lago at his home. We're finding out more and more about that. And you and I and Scott were talking about the clues, the things that really stuck out. And I haven't had a chance to run this by you, but have you looked at what the FBI supposedly found? They put photos of you know, covers, and things were marked out that you couldn't see, put it on the floor and took a photo of it. And those supposedly were some of the paraphernalia that they discovered at Trump's home. But did you happen to see what was in that box?
The box where they had the time.
Yes.
Some labels. And I'm one of those people. I'm very fair. I look at journalism like you and many others do. We have to be fair, regardless of how we feel one way or the other politically. We need to look at everything from both sides and find out who has the most to gain out of this. And looking at that, it almost, part of me thinks that Trump was trolling them. Mm-hmm. With that stuff there, you know, and the first thing that came to my head when I saw that on the floor was, can anybody really picture Trump in his suit sitting on the floor going through paperwork and stuff like that? It made no sense. And then the photos also had exhibit numbers, and they had the measuring rulers that we used on crime scenes already there. So who laid that out? Was that there when they got there, or was that something that they laid out to try to make Trump look like he's just being willy-nilly with all this, quote, classified information, which as the United States president, he has the right to declassify, unlike Hillary Clinton, who was not president. And, you know, our justice system is definitely showing that it's a one-sided justice system. But I almost feel, and this is from the research that I've done, is that what they were trying to receive was stuff that was incriminating to them. Crossfire, yes. Hurricane, the Russia collusion, and that kind of stuff. And they were trying to get it and then reclassify it. And that's where I sit right now.
Everything that the left has accused the right of, they've actually done. Yes. From the Russia collusion to, I mean, it blows my mind that other people don't see this, but there's still, we've talked about this and could go on just scratching our heads as to why people can't see sending money to Ukraine is like feeding a drug addict. And what is the most important thing or topic that's on your plate these days or right now, today?
My biggest thing is getting closer to God and trying to help other people, not through my words. Talk is so cheap. And that's what took me a while to get around to being a Christian, wasn't Christianity, but Christians themselves. You know, so I wanted to be different. I wanted people to be excited by my experiences and then come ask me questions, because that's how good conversation gets started. And right now it's so important because this world's falling apart. And there's no question. After the speech that Joe Biden gave the other night, if anyone had a question, if this was political, if they're not trying to get us to basically start a civil war between each other, it's very apparent now. And right now, it's my big thing, I think, is getting people to understand that this isn't Democrat, Republican. This is between God and the devil. This is between good and evil. Mm-hmm. We're all on the same side. We're all the children of God, no matter how you look at it. And we need to stop bickering amongst each other about stupid politics and start uniting with each other to save our country, to maintain our freedoms, to maintain our liberty. Exactly what Ted talked about. Like, this is where we're at right now. And, you know, we need to just, like I said, quit the bickering. We need to realize that we're Americans, and we're lucky to be Americans.
earlier today, we're recording this on Sunday, the day before Labor Day, and I went to church this morning and I thought, oh, I want to stop by the grocery store on the way back. Well, the worst time to go to the grocery store is right after church on Sunday, but also the day before Labor Day, like, or any holiday, like there was, it was just jam packed. So I'm pulling out and I'm cautious of people coming around me and walking behind me and everything. And I took my time and here comes this guy across from me and literally backed into me. And people, I heard somebody's horn blaring and then I saw him coming and I couldn't get my car back into drive quick enough. And he just nudged me a little bit. And so I got back into my parking slot and I put it in and park, and he took off. And the interesting thing though is that one woman was going to her car, walking to her car with a bag of groceries. She came walking up. Another woman came right behind me and stopped traffic. She held her hand out and she stopped in traffic. She took a photo of the car and she said, let me airdrop this to you. The other woman that came up said, I'm an attorney. If you need any help, let me know. My point is nobody stopped to say, well, are you a Democrat or Republican?
Yes. That's
humanity
awesome.
Is good overall. They are trying to divide us intentionally. As Ephesians says, Ephesians 6:12, we do not battle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the principalities of this dark world. And a lot of people really don't understand that. When you're talking to somebody, how do you get them to see? And sometimes, you know, we know the Bible tells us they just don't have eyes to see, but we're not giving up, are we?
No, we're not giving up. And it's kind of weird. It's a little easier for me sometimes when I'm out in public because I wear a kilt.
Yeah, and you're kind of a target there.
But the thing is, though, is that in the area that I live close to what I call Little China or Austin. And, you know, they see a guy in a kilt and they automatically assume I'm on their side. You know, so as long as I'm not wearing like a Punisher shirt or a MAGA hat or something like that, they'll actually take the time to listen. And what I started to do on social media, because social media is a very powerful tool. It was a weapon that they used against us that we ultimately use back against them. So what I've done is I've got three profiles that are set up where it's all labeled as if I'm a liberal. And what I do is because if they find out you're conservative, they stop listening immediately. They start going into tantrum mode. So what I do is I ask questions as a liberal. Like I'm like a liberal who's just waking up going, well, I don't understand this. If Trump did this and this, then why were there so many good articles about what he did for urban development back before he was president? So because questions are less intrusive than, you know, forward conversation. And I wake up a lot of people that way because then they start asking the same questions and it's all because they don't know what side of the political scale I'm on.
So do you post anything against Trump on your social media? Okay. So then it would be kind of hard to, do you post anything pro Biden?
I post nothing that's pro anybody.
You're just asking questions.
All I do is I'm a quote liberal asking questions. And like I said, his questions make them think because they either have to give me an answer, they have to go look it up. But as long as they think I'm on their side, they're less combative.
Yeah, that's true. That's a good point. I hadn't thought about that. I told you that I got banned permanently from Twitter, but Ted, my husband, is not. How is that possible?
I have no idea. I think that they wonder that if they were to get rid of Ted, then they would have bigger problems, lawsuits and stuff like that. And they may not have known who you were in order to do that because you're in the same boat as he is. But I see a lot of the check marks that are still there that don't get removed. And I've been removed twice. My lady has been removed 13 times.
Really?
Yeah. I've been removed. All of my stuff's been from my shows and my videos have been removed from YouTube. And that happened because Q dropped two of my videos onto the Q drops. And literally the next day, I watched 30 of my videos get removed. And then all of a sudden they said, we're just going to remove you. You broke every one of our rules.
Oh, my gosh. So what, do you come out as another name?
No, I ended up giving up on them because they do IP addresses and stuff. So they basically can tell, like, yes, if it's from the same, you know, so I can't get back on anything that I do. So I've moved over to Rumble. Rumble's been rather fair. They haven't tagged me or marked me for any of my videos. And my videos aren't, this is the way that it is. My videos are there to question and make you think, give you hope and stuff like that. So technically, there's nothing that they can come after me about. Like, even with the vaccinations, I didn't say these are poison. I said, you should think for yourselves and do your research kind of things.
Why, a year, 2 years ago, we were considered conspiracy theorists if we bucked the system. If we said, just take some vitamin C and zinc and get some good sunshine and exercise and eat right. And I think that contributed to me getting booted off Twitter. Here's the other thing. I'm much more upfront about my faith than Ted is. And about 20 years ago, 25 years ago, Ted and I used to have a magazine that was basically geared towards hunting. Do you know that about 25 years ago, I wrote an article about the University of, it was in Washington State. And one of these universities was starting to come out with, and this again, 25 years ago, they were coming out with a digital ID, and you couldn't buy anything other than through the digital ID. But I remember writing specifically that, wow, if you didn't return your library book on time back in the day when we had, library checkouts, if you didn't return your library book on time and then you wanted to go get something at the cafeteria using your digital card, you weren't able to. And I remember calling it something about the mark of the beast and what is this world coming to? I think I've been more pro faith and pro God and more out there, so to speak, about my faith than Ted has. And I think Christian conservatives are marked as far as the social media goes. What are your thoughts on that?
No question. You are 100% on target. And right now, I think the worst thing you could be in this country is a conservative, white, male Christian. And I'm not saying that the females and that don't have the same issues, but they're trying to remove the man from everything.
Yes.
Christianity is the biggest thing because a great example is when I was looking into who and why people were taking the vaccinations. I did a really deep study on this. And a lot of people were asking the questions like, what made certain people decide not to get it? And I put the conclusion together. The majority of them were Christians because Christians had enough faith in God to know that we don't need something. We've got everything that we need in order to cure ourselves. And we're not going to run out and take any kind of vaccination that hasn't even had studies yet. So that was the common denominator, where the Christians were the majority that weren't getting vaccinations. And then the next demographic next to Christians were people of color that weren't taking these vaccinations. And I started, well, that's interesting. So I started researching into that. And then you go and you find out is that especially African-American or Black people have been part of all these conspiracies. You know what I'm saying? Like, they are the ones that the government goes after first and different experiments. So they're more cautious than, your average white person is, which is great that, that they're already awake.
Yep. Well, they know what happened in Tuskegee.
That's a great example.
But, there are still a lot of Christians who did get the jab. And, look at, I just talked to somebody the other day and we were talking about that. And they said, she had to get it because of her job. But people, I think, are now waking up to the realization that more and more people I heard a number. I can't remember who it was from. I don't remember the source, but millions of people have been injured. And we know that VAERS isn't going to report everything. What is your latest take on how many people who have been injured from the vax, the jab? Let's call it the jab.
I want to say it's probably close to a million in our country, not to mention all the other countries, because you remember, go back 7 years ago when you would watch mainstream media, you would at least see 10 minutes a night per show talking about what's taking place overseas. You don't see that anymore.
Yeah. And
because these numbers are coming out over in Great Britain, especially, and many other countries about the damage that this has done. They were telling women that it was safe if you were pregnant to get this shot. Now they're going back on that. Just recently, the NIH has come out and finally admitted that ivermectin actually was a 92% preventative from even getting COVID, much less, you know, getting it severely. And they're still not talking about this. And the reason being is because they couldn't have put an emergency order through if they had had something else that worked. So what's happening is all these people really trusted the government, like, you know, this is good. And that was one thing that I have to say I was disappointed about Trump.
Yeah, let's go there. Go ahead.
I like Trump overall. However, I'm also a true citizen who thinks for himself. So if somebody, I don't care whose side they're on, does something that I question, I'm going to call them out on it. And, you know, with Trump, you know, because he had a lot of people that would really listen to him. So when he was, you know, talking about the vaccination, a lot of conservatives did get it. A lot of Christians went out and got it. And then it didn't hurt that our churches were telling them, you know, this is a God sent thing. God, you know, gave the wisdom to these people to create the vaccination, which had a lot of Christians that went out and got this, where they would normally be very, very precautious. You know, so we're at a point now where we're realizing it. People that took the vaccination are having small issues, whether it be, being lethargic, whether it, you know, leg cramps and stuff, or very, you know, most heart issues. And it's getting to the point now where they can no longer hide it. People are starting to see through it. They're waking up. So what does the media do? They start their campaign getting ready to blame Trump.
Yes.
For the vaccinations.
Yeah. And that's one thing. I'm not going to say I'm friends with President Trump, but I have been to the White House, had dinner with him at the White House. I served, still am part of an organization that Don Jr. is called Hunter Nation. And we are trying to get that up and running and also hunt the vote. We found out that millions and millions of people who are registered hunters don't vote. So we're trying to get them, encourage them to vote as well, because hunters are conservative.
Yes.
We can't tell them who to vote for since it's a 501c3, but we just encourage them to vote. And I did a couple of appearances with Don Jr. on that. So I do have his cell phone number. I don't abuse it. I've only used it a couple of times. But it is concerning that President Trump, I don't think he pushed the vax, but I think he did. Now that I think about it, I think he may have highly suggested it, but he also left it up to our discretion. If you don't want to get it, you don't have to. No mandates. He's always said that. Even when he was coming out with it, I knew that there was something wrong. I did my own research. And for me, we talked about this, because I got sick and almost died from toxic mold and no doctors could help me, I had to become my own investigative sleuth. I was dying. I had 4 different types of mold in my bloodstream and pre-emphysema. I couldn't walk up a flight of stairs if my life depended on it. And I went to dozens of doctors and nobody helped me. So when you get to that point where you get backed into a corner, you either wallow in the gutter or you try and figure it out. And that's always given me this discerning, like, something's wrong with this. Something's not right about this jab that they put together so quickly. Why would we want to take that? But yeah, I that's a big issue for me as well.
Yeah, it's, it hasn't turned me on Trump.
Right. You
know, because I also am fair enough to go back and look at what they put him through during the entire administration when he was our president. And they put him into another spot when this COVID, because we all know that this COVID wasn't an accident. This was at the very least, it escaped and it shouldn't have. At the very most, which is where I'm leaning, this was created. And and there's a patent on it. And you can't patent nature. Viruses are nature made. Therefore you can't patent it unless you created it. Then you can patent it. So there was a lot of weird things that came about it. And then when it came to Trump, and, you know, so what if Trump had just come out and said, don't take these vaccines, period? You would have had half the population turn on, you know, so he had to walk a fine line.
Well, it's interesting because, you know, there's video of Kamala Harris and a lot of Democrats saying, well, if Trump put that out there, I'm not going to take that. What I'm curious as to what changed their mind. And no reporter has ever asked that.
And you're right. And in a fair world, reporters would be asking the questions that we ask, because there's and that's the thing is, you and I were citizens of this country, and we're the ones asking these questions because we have these questions. Media, that's their job. Their job is to ask these important questions. They don't ever push back. Even when they would ask Trump questions, they weren't really questions. They were more provocative. You know what I'm saying? Like trying to push him towards saying something wrong.
Push his buttons.
Exactly. And now we've got a guy in residency that just disappears half the time. He's taking more vacations than anybody. He pops back up. He goes on vacation for 3 weeks. Somehow his numbers rise when he's not doing anything. And then he comes back and gives a speech that Hitler would have been smiling at.
Come on. Okay. So imagine, if you will, the red background that Joe Biden did his speech in front of. Imagine if that was President Trump there. What do you think everybody else would have said about him? And why aren't they saying it now?
Exactly. They would have been saying what we're saying about Biden's background, except the one difference is that Trump would have already been under investigation, if not already in handcuffs for treason or for, you know, turning on half of his country. Like literally, you know, this guy was supposed to be the unifier, the great unifier. Remember, Trump was the great divider, which I laughed at because he never did anything to divide anybody. It was literally the mainstream media that was. Now we get this guy who's like, I'm going to be the great unifier. And he comes out and I can't think of any president ever that has divided people worse than that last week, much less the speech that he gave on Thursday.
And Duncan, again, going back to what I said originally, everything that they have talked about doing or accused us of, they've done the opposite and they've actually done it. So instead of being the great unifier, he's the great divider. I mean, really, it's quite sad. I teach group fitness classes and I don't say, okay, Republicans on this side, Democrats on that side, libertarians in the back. We have lost sight of our humanity. And I think that's what's really such a shame, because it's divided families, this whole thing. It didn't happen under President Trump. Well, maybe it started to. Don't you think? People who were never Trumpers, that's really what started it.
I think it started, my opinion is it started during Obama's administration. Because if think back to before Obama became president, we didn't have these conversations about racism. Because I have been all over this world and I can't tell you that I've seen more than one racist person, and they were racist against Americans. It wasn't even a color issue. Then Obama came in and all of a sudden we've got this big division. People are wanting reparations and all this other stuff for what happened hundreds of years ago that we had nothing to do with.
Yeah.
And, you know, especially conservatives. Conservatives are very loving, open-minded people. I don't know any racist conservatives. I've been to multiple Trump rallies. It's the most accepting place ever, no matter what color you are. And now we've got this president and the liberals who claim to not be racist. But when you make everything about race, how are you not racist?
When you use a color in whatever it is you're saying or doing, or if you elect somebody based on their color, isn't that, I'm going to be you. I'm going to ask the question, isn't that racist?
That's exactly what racism is. Because if we were a normal society, we would have problems with what you do by your character, not by your color. I know that's, you know, Martin Luther King said it, but that's exactly the truth. Now everything seems to be about heritage, culture, color, and all this other stuff. And it wasn't like that, you know, before Obama administration. Like I said, it just kind of disappeared and then just came back. Then they're in this administration. That's their focus. I mean, they're calling us fascist. We're the ones. I will have no problem playing something from Kirsten Sinema or something when she says something good. A fascist would shut her down, period. You know, the ones who are shutting down our speech are the, quote, anti-fascists who are trying to keep us from being able to speak. So, I mean, literally, and the Bible said this, up's going to be down, right's going to be left. I mean, this is where we are definitely right now.
Is this not Babylon that we're living in?
I question this all the time. I was like, if God flooded the world out before, what's he waiting for now? How bad was
it? Well, he said he wouldn't. Yeah. So,
well, Jesus is the big difference between before and now. So I think, you know, we're getting a chance.
Yeah.
At this point, you know, God's given us the opportunity to use our free will to wake up, to help wake other people up. As he lifts the veil, our job is to turn people towards that veil to see what's underneath it. And I think this is what we're getting right now is an opportunity that, you know, because Jesus said it on the cross. He was like, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And and today's times aren't much different from when Christ was crucified, because around every corner is deception. They just, you know, they use different methods back then than they do today, but it's easier today because the worst weapon, the biggest weapon in this world is the one who controls information. And sadly, we have to create our microphones. The liberals get theirs.
Yeah. Information and food.
Yeah.
And food. I watched that movie, Piercy versus Goliath. Have you seen it?
I have not.
Scott posted it on another chat that we're on, and I happened to watch it, and it came out last year. I never heard about it. Christopher Walken starred in it, and it was amazing, but it was about this. It's a true story about a farmer in Canada who was up against Monsanto, and he came to this country. His ancestors came to this country bringing seeds with them. That was the most valuable thing that they owned, were seeds. And this farmer took such great care in planting crops and using seeds and finding out what worked and didn't work and not using Monsanto, but his neighbors started to. So they, Monsanto, started testing. They came on his property when he wasn't aware of it, and they tested his canola plants and found out that they had some Monsanto in it, which means it's a patent. And if you grow that, you can't sell it, or you got to pay for the patent. And so the whole, it's really a sad story. Honestly, I hope you're not going to watch it because I just gave it away. But it's really sad because it makes you think, you know, this poor farmer did nothing wrong. Just because the wind blew the wrong direction and maybe or maybe not blew some chemicals onto his plants. And still, that's the thing. It's your word up against Goliath. And we all know what happened, but it kind of seems like that for Christian conservatives, that we're up against Goliath right now. What do you think?
I agree with you 100%. And I literally have to have certain people in my life make sure that I keep the rocks in my pocket instead of starting to throw them, because I'm getting to that point, you know, where I feel like we've already reached the point of no return and we need to stand up. But a revolution which needs to take place can be done without violence. And, you know, I encourage people that too, is that when it's time to throw rocks, we'll have no question. God will be like, it's time, guys. But right now, just what you were saying, I don't know if you heard in Canada, the Environmental Protection Agency equivalent up in Canada was going on farmers' property. And some farmers called them and they said, oh, we're just testing your water. Well, if they were doing something legit, they would have knocked on doors, been like, hey, right, test your water. So the farmers went and tested their water afterwards and found poisons, like anthrax was one of the main ones in the water, which feeds these cows. And if you're noticing, Canada, United States, Great Britain, India, there's been loads of cattle that have been dying on top of, you know, fires and fields that produce large amounts of grains. You know, we're getting shortages on the things that farmers absolutely need in order to grow the crops that they have. And right now, it you know, if it's not apparent yet, it's going to be really apparent when the shelves are empty in the stores. We're about to go into a food crisis.
Yeah,
they're saying it all over the news, over in England, over in France, yes, over in Italy. We're not getting that news, so people don't realize how dire the situation is yet.
And it's interesting because as hunters, I've always said that, you know, we're never going to starve. I hunt with a bow and arrow, and I have been for 30 years. But now there's a new thing that they're doing in the state of Texas, and they're doing it in other states as well. There is something called chronic wasting disease, CWD, that if there is one animal on your property that has it, they're going to come in and wipe out the whole herd. And you can't be there on the property when they do.
Yep.
Like, who makes up these rules?
I know the answer, but go ahead. Yeah, the deep state makes these rules. And that's the thing, is that a great example, too, that goes along with what you were just saying. There's a lot of people, Christians, a lot of conservatives that are getting that are being proactive, and they're getting ready. They're planting their gardens. They're learning how to hunt and stuff. But we've got these chemtrails and stuff in the air, which are ruining our soils. So even like myself, I had a garden. I have two gardens going. I have one in my yard, which is an above the ground garden. And then we did a really nice four bed community garden down the road from where I live. I helped a widow build this for our community.
Nice. But we put
irrigation and everything in the hearse. The hearse is doing a little better. Mine, I was just watering and stuff, and everything started getting these like white mold spots on them.
Yeah.
And it always got worse when I would notice the days where we just had loads of stripes in our skies. You know, the conspiracy theory of chemtrails, right?
Yeah, I know. There's still people who don't believe in it. And you know, whenever I bring these things up to Ted, for example, I've had to, in a way, red pill him. He's very smart about a lot of things. And it's the stuff that the gray area, when I bring things up like chemtrails, if he can see it and, you know, read about it and have a published paper printed about it, then he might agree with it. But when I say things like that, he'll like, well, that doesn't make sense. Well, a lot of this doesn't make sense to anybody. Why do you think they would want us to be in this situation? And this is one of the questions that Ted had. If that were true, wouldn't it be affecting their families as well?
It absolutely would. But there's one thing that we also have to ask ourselves. If our government is corrupt enough to poison us from the skies, would they also be corrupt enough to have cures for certain things that we don't have access to? Preventatives, you know, like cancer cures or any of this other stuff. And that's the thing, is that they are that bad. And I always tell people too, because I have a lot of people that didn't believe in the chemtrail thing for a while. And I said, ask yourself one question. When you were young, riding your bikes around, you know, when you were always outside, remember back in the day, mom said, don't come in until the lights come on.
Yes.
Tell me what the skies look like. Did you see then what we see now? And I was like, airplanes have been around since I was a kid. So it's not like, you know, they just started getting stratosphere issues, and that's where these lines come from. I said it's all happened within the last 12 years. I said so vision what you saw as a kid, and now vision what you see today. And that's what usually makes them start thinking about it, because you're right.
Congressman Jim Jordan was talking about they've had 14 whistleblowers come forward in the FBI. I would hope that there's more. I would hope that whoever is putting the chemtrail, I mean, we've seen photos of them on planes. We've seen them in action. Somebody's doing that. I would hope that somebody has a conscience and they would start speaking out about this, because yeah, it's going to get back to them, the everyday people who are just trying to make ends meet. They're trying to, you know, get ready for Labor Day and have a good barbecue, but somebody's going to have a heavy conscience before people are going to wake up.
Yeah. And this is where it takes people like you and me running for office. We've been convinced that it takes the attorney, the suit wearers, to be the politicians. But you know what? We don't need that, because if we had people like us in there, we would be writing bills that were only about the bill we were writing. Your average American can sit down, read it, and understand it. This is where we need to go, because we're the ones with the courage. Marjorie Taylor Greene,
yeah,
is a great example. Like she, yeah, I don't know if you saw yesterday, but Bannon from War Room asked her, you know, about all the threats to her life and all this other stuff, and she's like, I'm never going to stop. I'm always going to be
her.
You're not going to kill me. This is the attitude we need right now, because this is the way I look at it. I would be willing to be loud, be honest, wake the world up, and lose my life in the process, knowing that my kids could have a world that I would be happy handing over to them. I don't feel, like I said, we need to get over the fear. And they're trying to propose more fear into us. January 6th, this speech the other night, because they know the most likely to rebel are the constitutionalists, because we know our constitution. We know we have the rights granted to us in order to remove tyrannical government. So they keep putting these things out there to scare us, to put us into submission so that we're not on the streets protesting. And I'm the last person. I'm not saying go to arms. Like, by no means do we need to go to arms, because they're trying to lull us into that. But we also need to stop being afraid to stand on the side of the road with signs, to walk around with t-shirts that have messages on it. Like, any way that we can wake people up,
yep,
that's what we need to do.
Ted's got hats and flags, and he sold out of them on his tour that say, "I will not comply." And I think that's what's really important is, in what you said too, I actually did think about getting into politics, and I kind of got talked down off that and talked out of it. But I think that more and more people, everyday people, are thinking about it as well. And if you don't want to get into politics, you could do your part by showing up. And on election day, number one, of course, voting on election day, getting everybody else to vote on election day, but also volunteering. And when you see something, say something. Because do you think, you know, we've heard from, talking about voting, we've heard from Mike Lindell. We've seen Dinesh D'Souza. You've probably seen it, the 3,000 mules?
2,000
mules. Was it two or three?
It was 2,000.
2,000 mules. So we know all this information is coming out, and 107 has another organization that is really helping to uncover a lot of things. But what's going to happen? Do you think that any of this is really going to matter?
I do, in one way. And like you said perfectly, we need to go vote on election day. You can't give them an out. You can't let them have a possibility of throwing your vote out or adding more votes. And what gave me a little bit of hope, because I mean, I was right on board with Scott Kesterson, where, like, we have no honest elections. What's the point of voting? Now we're both like, listen, we need to go overwhelm these people.
Yes.
And that is the key. After what I saw in Arizona, I now know it's possible. Because what happened in Arizona is, so many people went out and voted for Carrie Lake during that election that they didn't cheat enough. And since our eyes were on them in the elections this time, because we know what was going on, they couldn't cheat forwardly like they did last time. So if we go out in large numbers and we end up voting on election day, we have a great chance of turning this all around, because people are very skeptical right now. Their eyes are open. I myself have volunteered to stand outside of my polling area and keep my eyes on things like that. Those are the little things that we can do, because if they know they're being watched, like, a crook isn't going to do a crime if they know that they're being watched.
Yep. You know what I think we should do? We should get with Scott and a few other people, whoever wants to help us, unless somebody already has. Let's have a plan. What can we do? What can people who are volunteering do? Say you're in, you know, you're near Austin. You could go to certain, you know, have a checklist and go to your polling station and say, you could say, I'm going to watch this one. You watch that one. I'm going to be here from this time to that time. And maybe we get more people involved and we just take pictures and we don't stand. We cannot comply. We're on to them. We saw what happened in Michigan. We saw how they shut down the polls, and then they pulled suitcases from underneath the tables, and we let it happen. Duncan, we've been asleep. And this has awakened the sleeping giant. What do you think?
I agree. Matter of fact, this is how I feel right now. We have let our country down. We've let our children down. We've let our God down. And I'm part of that. You know, I'm not throwing it on you. I'm saying we did in general. And it's because we're listening to the people that were giving us information that weren't necessarily on our side. We've always been taught, you know, the government's here, they're going to take care of us, make sure everything's okay, which didn't turn out to be the case. So now that we're awake, this is our battle. We can't hand this to our kids. Our kids aren't going to have a battle to fight, because in our lifetimes, if we don't fix things now, they're going to take away our arms, which, you know, at the very least, taking away our ability to hunt and survive for ourselves, and much less protect ourselves. They're going to come for our Bibles once they take our arms, because they know they can't come for the Bibles first. Bibles will be after they come for our arms. And then all of a sudden, now they're trying to remove our God from the equation, because they want obedient sheep. They don't want people to think for themselves. They don't want people like us that have so much faith in our God. We're like, bring it on. Bring whatever you have on. I know God's going to take care of us. They don't like that. We are a bane to our government right now.
Well, they know that their days are numbered. That's why they're scrambling. They're trying to do, you know, it's like the Titanic ship is sinking and it's going down and they're grabbing onto a lawn chair or something, anything that could save them. And they're hoping that something will stick. And we're onto them. We know we have awakened, and there's too many hunters in this country. There's too many people who take their, who know, maybe they don't even hunt, but they've had a gun or two or 10, whatever, for protection. And when they say things like, this is the big one. And I've learned so much, obviously, from being married to Ted. He knows everything about guns. But one of the things that that came up, I probably would have bought into this. Okay. So, you know, you have a black, scary looking gun and you call it an assault weapon, right? Because it's black and scary. It's probably not as powerful of one. I have a pink AR and it just looks pretty, but that's pretty deadly. You know what I mean? Yeah. But let's say, okay, this is a paperweight. It's pretty heavy. If I were to hit you on the side of the head, that would be an assault weapon, would it not?
100%. A pencil, a spoon, anything I can harm someone with would technically be an assault weapon. And my big thing too, like you said, with the different types of weaponry, I would trust my 45 taking someone down before I would trust my rifle. You know what I'm saying? Because they're bigger, they're thicker, they would just do more damage. And that's the thing, is that eventually they're going to start calling handguns assault weapons. And then eventually they're going to start calling BB guns assault weapons. And they're just going to take away everything they can. You know, I don't know. I wouldn't feel comfortable walking into a war with what I can own. Now, we can own those, but you have to surpass certain of your amendment rights. If you do get like a weapon of war, like a literal weapon that they would use as a Marine or something like that. This is just a big, scary thing, because at the same time, we're not the problem. Like, gun violence in this country isn't even close to the amount of people that are dying from like fentanyl and stuff like that.
That's what's really scary. All these fighting aged men coming across the border with fentanyl, that's what's terrifying. And more young people, you know, I've heard recently that they're making the fentanyl pills look like candy and handing them out. There's got to be some, it's just pure evil to think that, number one, you would allow that in your home. I look at our country as like our house. Would you leave the doors open to your home all the time? Would you invite people in? At what point do you have to say, look, we'd love to have you for dinner, but we have to feed our family first. We have to take care of our own first.
And we should, you know, we should be taking care of our veterans first and foremost.
Yes.
You know, they're homeless all over the place. I spent a month and a half. Scott Kesterson from Bards FM sent me down to the border for a month and a half.
Seriously?
Oh, yeah. So I was down Eagle Pass, Del Rio, all in that area. And I saw with my own eyes what was coming over. I saw I'm not going to get into that. It's really graphic, but I the trafficking and stuff that they talk about on the news with the children is very, very real. My eyes, I knew that this stuff existed, but my eyes really opened up spending time down there. I went and not only talked to authorities, but I talked to the citizens that live there, just your average everyday people. And one thing they all had in common, we love immigrants, but we want them to come in and do this legally. And this was, you know, both, you know, white people, this was Mexicans that have come over here to our country. And one thing that I did notice is that the Mexicans that came over here legally have a bigger problem with this influx right now of immigration coming over than the average American does.
Yep. Yeah. Because they're work. Where are they going to go? Where are they going to live? How are they going to survive? I'm worried that, or let me ask you, are you worried that they are here and awaiting orders, and one day something big's going to happen and we're going to see really an amazing in the worst sense of the way, an amazing assault on American citizens?
Yes. I truly believe that. I saw with my very own eyes. They keep saying that these families are coming over. I saw like four or five families. Majority, 95% of what I saw were males that were basically 21 on up to their lower 40s. My first question was, are these sleepers? Mm-hmm. Are they coming in here to cause problems down the road? Now I'm starting to wonder if these are the United Nations soldiers that are coming in through the guise of immigration so that we don't ask questions as to why these blue helmets are coming into our country.
Right. Oh, man. Well, Duncan, I could talk to you for another 5 hours, but yes. Let's do this again if you have time in the near future, and let's get caught up and share a campfire, so to speak, about what's going on in the world.
That sounds great. Absolutely. And in the next couple of weeks, I would love to get you on my show. We do live and we do a lot of conversation. One thing about my show that I love is I like to incorporate the people in chat into the show. I kind of look at it as a community show. So people get to ask questions and we just kind of go back and forth with them just about the same topics here. And, you know, it's so important right now that we at the very least talk about this, help wake people up. But we just need to realize that God gave us everything we need. You know what I'm saying? So if some of this materialism gets removed from us, God's still going to give us shelter. He's going to give us food, water, and what we need. We just need to have trust in them and don't fall for the tricks of the mark of the beast, because that is coming.
Yeah. Well, I would love to end with a prayer. Would you like to lead it?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. Everyone, please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for everything that you blessed us with. I want to thank you for the opportunity to come here with Shemaine and the many other people that are fighting, not only for this world and its country, but for you, dear Lord. Dear Lord, I want to ask you to give us the courage, discernment, and patience during these times, as we need it more than we ever have. Please keep the evil and the temptation out of our lives, but let us, dear Lord, learn how to pray for our enemies, because with you, you can change the heart of the most cold person in this world. Dear Lord, I ask that you lift us up every time we fall as we're walking down that narrow path, because we're going to make mistakes every single day, but we're trying to do better, dear Lord. So please forgive us for our sins and let us move forward to be the best people that we can be and help inspire others to do the same, dear Lord, because we are all your children. Please, dear Lord, bless these children and put a hedge of protection over them until we can help. We need to make this world a better place at the very least for the kids going forward, dear Lord, but we need to serve you and put you before anything. So let us appreciate all that we've gotten. Let us not just take time for prayer to ask for what we need, but let us take the time to pray just to thank you, dear Lord, for what you have blessed us with. Beautiful family, great friendship. Anything that you take away from us, you give back to us tenfold, dear Lord, and I am grateful for that. So please, dear Lord, let us be the best servants that we have, that we can be down here on this earth. Let us serve you in every way we can. Let us be your arms, your voices, your feet, and everything down here on this earth, dear Lord, to be your greatest warriors, because you have picked us all to be here at this very time. We love you, dear Lord, in Jesus Christ's name and our Heavenly Father's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you so much, Duncan. And for everyone who wants to check out Duncan's show, how many times a week are you on Podbean?
Yeah, I do 5 days a week. I am right after Bard's FM's first show. So I go on at 9:30 Central Time.
Okay.
And on Saturday and Sunday, we do a show at 7 o'clock Central Time called Brothers in a Bible, which is part of Kilted Chirstian. Sadly, my brother who does the show with me has been really sick from a spider bite, Black Widow or Brown Widow. So he's been out for a couple of weeks, but we will be getting back to that next week. I just wanted to make sure that he had time to rest, relax, and heal. So please pray for my brother Jeff too, please.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, thank you again so much, Duncan, for joining me. And I'm sure I'll be talking to you soon.
Oh, absolutely. And it's been an absolute honor to be on the show and a privilege to meet you last weekend.
Oh, awesome. Thanks everybody for watching, and please like and share and rate this show so that more people can see it and we can help wake up others. All right, guys, I'll talk to you next time. And if you want to find out more about the superfood nutrition that my husband and I take and that has changed our lives, please email me at wildlywell21@gmail.com. That's wildlywell, W-I-L-D, wildlywell21@gmail.com, because there are so many different products and I want to make sure you get what you need. All right, guys, I'll talk to you next time. Have a great rest of your day. Bye for now.